Molt bona tarda. Anava a dir benvinguts a l'Escola Superior de Música de Catalunya, però em sembla que la majoria sou de la casa. Em sembla que la majoria sou de la casa i per tant la benvinguda li podem donar al nostre convidat, però em sembla que la resta som, ens coneixem força d'aquí la casa. Em fa molta il·lusió poder inaugurar aquestes segones jornades absentits que el Joan Grimal prepara amb tantes ganes que aquesta significació musical esdevingui realment significativa per tothom. Jo els hi deia ara, aquí al costat, que quan jo estudiava la teoria de la música era una cosa que feia basarda. Segurament perquè tenia una estretíssima mirada, no només exclusivament musical, sinó moltes vegades ni exclusivament musical. No? I que, en canvi, podem disposar, gràcies a l'esforç que han fet tants professors, tants investigadors, tants intèrprets, tants directors, tants compositors, de tenir tota una mirada molt polièdrica sobre què és això de la música. No? Una mirada polièdrica que estàvem allà apuntant-nos, no? Que de vegades és sociològica, que de vegades és històrica, que de vegades és pedagògica, que de vegades és econòmica, que de vegades és de gestió, o és terapèutica, o és comunitària, o és urbana, o és artística, o és antropològica, o sonològica, o interpretativa, o psicològica, no? I que, per tant, podríem afegir segurament moltes més mirades sobre la música que fessin que aquesta significativitat anés més enllà de la pròpia significativitat intrínseca que aquesta nova teoria musical, diferent de la que vam estudiar alguns, prengués en compte. No? I la veritat és que veient el programa d'aquest any veia com realment tots els llenguatges musicals ja estan d'una o altra manera representats i que a més fa molta il·lusió també institucionalment que professorat d'aquí i de fora, alumnat, graduats i fins i tot antics directors generals, i per tant he vist que en Pau Monterde, que no m'ha precedit directament però m'ha precedit amb un parell endarrere, també aportaran valor i coneixement en aquestes jornades. Per tant, gràcies Joan per fer-ho possible i gràcies a vosaltres per convertir-ho. No els he presentat, però el Joan Grimal el coneixeu perfectament i a la Melissa Mercadal, la directora acadèmica, probablement també, i si no, si et sembla, Melissa, parles una mica per ell i t'acabarem de conèixer.
Welcome. Bé, simplement afegir dues petites coses al que diu la Núria. Certament ens fa il·lusió inaugurar aquestes segones jornades, també com a precedent del que serà el Congrés Internacional d'aquesta temàtica de significació musical que tindrà lloc aquí al setembre del 4 al 8, no? Joan, del 2020, per tant, bé, són preparacions a un espai que encara serà més gran i de compartir amb més gent arreu del món. Jo trobo especialment bonic el títol d'aquestes jornades, que diu la significació musical, una eina per humanitzar el món. Penso que és rellevant. No? El fet que la música també es miri més enllà del valor intrínsec de la pròpia música, de la pròpia art, sinó què més, no? Que, com més la música pot contribuir a la nostra vida i al nostre entorn. I també el fet que tindrà un caràcter més pràctic aquest any, en el sentit que es comentaran els concerts i hi haurà moltes més interpretacions, de manera que tot aquest tema de l'expressivitat, no? De l'anàlisi de l'expressivitat de la música, de quina manera contribueix i influeix a l'hora d'interpretar. Per tant, espero que ho gaudirem molt i un altre cop benvinguts a l'ESMUC i gràcies per participar en aquestes jornades.
Joana? Sí, Joan, que ens donaràs tot de claus per situar-nos.
Bienvenidos, bienvenidos, welcome, especially in the Plymouth University of Leeds, our main guest speaker in the second edition of the Jornadas Absentes. Hem fet alguns canvis respecte a la primera edició de les jornades. M'agradaria presentar-vos-els. En primer lloc, a veure si funciona això. Ah, sí. En primer lloc, el tema dels organitzadors. Els organitzadors som mitja dotzena. En Rolf Becca, Laia Grimal, jo mateix, Rubén López Cano, Melissa Mercadal, que són els organitzadors. Per tant, no he estat sol ni molt menys, molt ben acompanyat. El comitè científic, cal afegir aquests, en Joaquim Rabasseda i la Sofia Martínez. Moltes gràcies a tots. Hem procurat incentivar la participació d'estudiants i d'alumni, perquè pensem que en el fons això no deixa de ser una escola, per tant és essencial, i també perquè va ser la part segurament més atractiva de les primeres jornades, la part on els estudiants i alumni van comunicar. Per tant, això ho hem eixamplat, tenim dues sessions. Després hi ha, com deia la Melissa, els concerts comentats, on es dona una mica més d'espai per cantar, tocar i parlar-ne. I després hem també canviat la paritat de gènere. Hem buscat també una paritat de gèneres musicals, que hi hagi una diversitat que respongui més a com és l'escola i no ens quedem només amb la música clàssica. I després hem afavorit les propostes col·laboratives, és a dir, no tant les comunicacions individuals com grups de dos, tres, on hi hagi un sonòleg amb un compositor, un musicòleg amb un intèrpret, etc. Aquestes col·laboracions pensem que són molt fructíferes. També el tema del diàleg és una cosa que es troba a faltar molt sovint en congressos, no? Que cadascú deixa anar el seu rotllo i després falta poder-ne parlar, poder dialogar. No? Aquí hem buscat uns espais suficients, jo crec, perquè després de cada sessió podem entrar en discussió entre nosaltres, entre els ponents, però després també entre les persones que hagin escoltat. Per tant, aquí realment diàleg pren un sentit fort, o sigui, no és només que jo parlo, és també que jo t'escolto, perquè si no després no et puc dir res del que a mi m'interessa, si no t'he escoltat. We also decided that the English language should have an increased presence at the jornadas. So, because we think it's a good thing for the school, and also for every one of us. It's an important thing. And finally, the ambitious motto that Melissa already la significació musical, una eina per humanitzar el món. In English, it would be something like musical signification, to humanize the world. Yes, we believe that music belongs traditionally to humanities, and therefore it is connected to the word, to speech, and this is quite an important point. It means that talking about music as a message brings closeness between people. It's our experience. All of us have experienced this. It creates ties between music and musicians, among musicians, and also between musicians and their world outside, non-musicians. Yes, getting to know each other. This is also an important point for us. We don't know what we're doing, what our neighbor next door is doing, and all we know, if we have lunch together in the Lanterna, then we can have a little talk about what everyone's doing, but here we have the opportunity, students and colleagues, to listen to each other, to share our experiences and our research, and to discuss about it. So this is, it should be a chance to do that. La Marisa de Leudaia Show, we have a pragmatic approach to theory. As much as we love theory, if it's not related in some way to teaching practice, to analysis practice, to performance practice, we're not really interested. It's not a theory for its own sake. And then we're very proud to be creating, we're creating and reinforcing a network of friends in institutions who share our point of view. For instance, El Conservatorio de Tortosa, the University of Zagreb in Croatia, University of Vilnius in Lithuania, of Helsinki in Finland, and so on. So we intend to reinforce this network. This network, it's an important point as well. This brings me to the Congress that Melissa mentioned already. We would like to invite you cordially to join this 15th edition of the Congress on Musical Signification that will take place here in this month. In September next year. Please send your paper proposals. That's it. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Moltes gràcies a vosaltres pel vostre suport, gràcies al comitè, gràcies als organitzadors i sobretot gràcies a vosaltres que amb la vostra presència activa donareu sentit a les jornades en sentit.
So it is my pleasure and my honor to present Professor Clive McClelland from the University of Leeds. And Clive és un musicòleg molt seriós que segueixo des de fa molts anys. Estic supercontent de poder-lo presentar aquí i que vosaltres hi pugueu entrar en contacte.
Lo siento.
Després és també un intèrpret, és un director coral molt amic de Schubert, això és una cosa també molt especial, i sobretot és un professor. Veureu que és una persona que té ganes d'ensenyar. Això es nota de seguida. Us parlarà de dos dels topoi que ell ha estudiat més a fons en l'òpera del 18, que són Ombra i Tempesta, i també us parlarà d'una manera desmistificadora del suposat topos Sturm und Drang, que és una cosa que es feia servir a la musicologia del segle XX i que ell d'alguna manera ha mostrat com prové d'aquests topoi operístics i que, per tant, ell ens explicarà que ja no el necessitem. Si vosaltres no fèieu servir el topos de Sturm und Drang, no cal que us preocupeu, no l'aprengueu. Aneu de cara a Ombra i Tempesta, que és el que realment interessa. Per tant, thank you very much for being here with us.
Thank you very much. Hello everyone, I'll be speaking in English. I will try to do it slowly so that you can follow if I start to get too fast, because it's my favorite topic, so I get excited. Just, whoa, slow me down, that will be fine. Okay, so I have some music examples to play to you later. I'm not familiar with this technology, so it may go wrong, just bear with me. But it's important to illustrate what I'm talking about, because it's difficult to describe in words sometimes the sort of music that I'm studying and writing about. So the music examples are really important, I think, for you to understand it. So as Johan said at the beginning of the talk, I've been working in two styles. One style is called ombra, and ombra is slow, creepy, scary music, and is designed to leave you in a state of shock and awe, and your emotions are suspended by this kind of music. And then we have this other kind of music, and this music has been around for a long time. People know the phrase Sturm und Drang. And some of you are nodding, yes, I know Sturm und Drang. I have a big problem with the term Sturm und Drang. I don't think we should use this term, and today I will explain to you why. Instead, I think we should use the word Tempesta. And Tempesta is for fast, stormy music, the kind of music that makes you panic, that makes you feel in a state of terror. And these two styles complement each other. Ombra is slow, Tempesta is fast, but they both share characteristics that make them, that disrupt the music. It's about not having the normal progressions, not having four-bar phrases, not having gentle modulations to the dominant, not having beautiful melodic lines. Instead, you have syncopation and diminished sevenths and flat minor keys and trombones and all the things that are designed to make the audience feel frightened. So that's the background, if you like, to the paper I'm about to give you, so that you have some context for what I'm talking about. And if you want a closer look at the books afterwards, feel free to do that. So, as I've explained, Tempesta is a term that I've recently coined to apply to music that exhibits agitated or violent characteristics in order to evoke terror and chaos. Features of the style include fast tempo, rapid scale passages, driving rhythmic figurations, strong accents, full textures, and robust instrumentation, including prominent brass and timpani. Examples of musical storm depictions stretch right back to the operas of the early 18th century, where audiences could experience spectacular stage effects, including sound effects provided by wind machines and thunder sheets, you know, the big sheets where they make the sound like the thunder, as well as powerful music for a true attack on the senses. Storm scenes were especially popular in the operas of the French court at the beginning of the 18th century, where the plots frequently allowed opportunities for divine intervention, for the gods to come down and interfere with mankind in some way. This association between storms and the supernatural is of central importance to my argument. The Age of Reason might well be able to offer a strong scientific reason to explain extreme weather conditions, but superstitions persisted, and storms still offered a very real sense of danger to anyone unfortunate enough to be caught out in a storm. Composers soon came to realize that in order to write more effective storm music, they would need to find ways not just to represent the storm, but to convey the feeling of danger to the audience, to pass that emotion over. And this was a process that happened gradually through the 18th century. It's difficult to pinpoint precisely when the transition took place, but it seems clear to me that at the start of the 18th century, the emphasis was on representing the storm through simple tone painting. But by the end of the century, there was a clear intention on the part of composers to provoke feelings of terror and awe in the audience. The devices that 18th century composers employed for storms in the theatre began to find their ways into other kinds of music, including sacred music, where texts that dealt with storms and other terrifying events such as earthquakes and damnation gave rise to appropriately frightening music, although in a church context these were naturally toned down a little bit. There were some constraints on being too excessive in church. Programmatic instrumental pieces with stormy content soon began to prove popular, with picturesque depictions of storms in individual movements of concertos and symphonies. Examples include programmatic works by composers like Vivaldi, Van Hal, Dittersdorf, Knecht, and of course Beethoven, the Pastoral Symphony, a very famous example of an orchestral storm. In particular, the emerging genre of the symphony provided the opportunity for composers to introduce stormy-sounding elements, but in an abstract context, including the so-called Sturm und Drang symphonies of Haydn, but also some of his contemporaries. Haydn was not alone in writing these Sturm und Drang-type symphonies. This is not just about tone painting. The aim seems to have been for Haydn and these other composers to explore the territory, to look at the ways this music could be used for rhetorical effect, to make a philosophical argument, if you like, as part of their music. And this would help to gain the attention of the listener and to provoke an emotional response from the listener. And this is done by disrupting the conventional musical language of the day, introducing discontinuities in pitch, in rhythm, in timbre, and in dynamics. And all of these things in combination would unsettle the audience, make the audience feel uncomfortable. Now, the label Sturm und Drang is unsatisfactory as an identifier of this kind of music. The stylistic origins clearly lie much earlier than the German literary Sturm und Drang movement, deriving from storm scenes, including floods, earthquakes, and fires in early operas. And also a supernatural association is evident because these scenes are usually initiated and sometimes stopped by angry gods who make the storm, and then maybe they quell the storm as well at the end. So by using the word tempesta, we avoid this misleading association of this kind of music with the German literary Sturm und Drang. I should remind you, this phrase Sturm und Drang comes from a play by Klinger, and the date of this play is 1776. Just think about this, 1776. And the Haydn Sturm und Drang symphonies were written 1768 to 1773. So they predate even the phrase Sturm und Drang. And in fact, we will see today, there are much earlier examples of Sturm und Drang type symphonies written long before the German literary Sturm und Drang. There's another problem with the Sturm und Drang. It's not supernatural. There are no gods, witches, demons, ghosts in the Sturm und Drang literature, in Klinger, in Goethe, in Schiller, whoever. The pain, the storm, comes from emotion. It's people who are rejected in love, who are suicidal, and nothing to do with gods or demons or anything like this. So it's a false association completely, this music with the German literature. Composers and publishers of concertos and symphonies in the 18th century frequently used the word tempesta as a descriptive label for storm depictions, with works or individual movements headed La Tempesta. And the term aria di tempesta for operatic arias of a stormy nature was widely recognised. So you might have a singer who is angry or is ready to fight, who sings a stormy aria, and it's a metaphor. It's a storm that the person feels inside them. So the style is the same. The Italianate word La Tempesta, probably the same in Spanish. Is it Tempesta in Spanish?
In Catalan.
Yeah, in Catalan. Okay, fine. So this word reflects the tradition, and of course it goes with ombra. Ombra is an Italian word as well. This term has been around for over 100 years to describe ghost scenes. So tempesta, ombra, they go together much better, being from the same language. Both of these terms then have associations with the supernatural, and they share many musical characteristics. So the theatrical origins of both these topics lie in supernatural scenes. And if you look at figure one on your handout, so you can see that ombra is used for ceremonial music, but ceremony when it's something dark, a ritual of some kind. So for processions, for rituals, for sacrifices, for funerals, for prophecies or oracles, when an oracle speaks. This is in the ombra style, famous example in Mozart's Idomeneo, when the oracle speaks, accompanied by three horns and two trombones and nothing else. Very scary. Ombra is also used for ominous settings, so for sorcery, for incantation, if a witch is going to make a magic spell, for ghosts, for statues in Don Giovanni, the famous example, the statue comes in, that's ombra. Caves or dungeons, anything like that. Tombs or death, ombra is used for that. At the other end of the diagram, we have tempesta, obviously used for storms, floods, earthquakes, fire, of course. And then as a metaphor for somebody who is experiencing rage or flight, they want to run away from trouble, or conflict, they want to fight the trouble. So it's the fight or flight response that psychologists talk about. And also madness. When someone's crazy, then you could use tempesta. Sometimes ombra, but usually tempesta. In the middle, we have scenes which are set in hell, in the underworld. And these could be ombra, or they could be tempesta, depending on the kind of scene that's taking place. If you are meeting the god of the underworld for the first time, this might be very scary, you might be in awe, and this might be ombra music. If you are being pursued by demons or the furies, then this is very fast music, and so, of course, it will be tempesta. So it depends on the context. And, of course, coupled with these types of example, very often you had elaborate stage designs. One of the classic stage designs of the 18th century was the mouth of hell. Great big mouth, literally with teeth and with gates. And with a sign that says, abandon hope, all ye who enter here, lascia ogni speranza, voi che entrate, and flames coming out, and people being scared. And the set designers love this. And it's very interesting that when they advertised Mozart's Idomeneo, it was Idomeneo, re di Creta, set designs by Qualio, in big letters, in small letters, music by Mozart. So people went for the spectacle, to be frightened, like we go to a horror movie now. So it's the same thing. So with both ombra and tempesta, discontinuous elements are incorporated into the music. Things happen to break up the normal patterns. The important difference between the two is speed, is tempo. Okay, ombra is slow, or maybe moderate andante, but no more than that. Tempesta is always fast. It has to be fast for a storm. So that's the important difference. There are some other differences, but those are the main ones. And as I said before, the slower ombra gives rise to awe and fear, shock. And the faster tempesta is for terror and panic and running away. When a composer employs either of these styles, or sometimes both, since they often happen together, especially in infernal scenes, he can therefore be seen to be going beyond just pictorialism, just depicting stormy music, for instance, but aiming to move the audience, to change the emotional state of the listener. This is the important thing. And of course, therefore, Ombra and Tempesta are important because they are seen as the forerunners of the Romantic movement. In the Romantic music, the idea is to move the listener with to lots of different kinds of emotions. But Ombra and Tempesta were the first two styles to do this early in the 18th century. So I want to concentrate today more on Tempesta. And as I say, it's used to express all kinds of turmoil, all kinds of problems that might be metaphorical that someone is feeling. It can communicate rage, panic, passion, pursuit, conflict, madness. These are all recurring themes in the Romantic repertoire as well as in the 18th century. And they are present throughout much of the music in the 18th century. The audience is expected not just to listen and observe at a distance, but to participate emotionally in the experience. So if you have a scenario where the heroine is abandoned in a storm, this allows the composer both to depict the storm itself, but also to convey the terror that the heroine is feeling while she is in the storm, and also to convey a sense of terror to the audience so that they feel the terror as well, and they identify with the heroine, and they say, oh, this poor woman is in the storm. What's going to happen? Will the hero come and rescue her? We hope. And this dynamic also works even when it's not opera. It can work purely in instrumental music, this idea of conveying a message to the audience and asking for them to invest their emotions in the music. In abstract instrumental works, the use of stormy elements is best accounted for in relation to topic theory, which is what we're doing at this conference, I think, quite a lot, where a musical idea derives from one location and is used in another. That's basically what topic theory is. From about the 1760s, Tempesta is identifiable as a topic which derives from theatrical storm scenes, but which can operate in abstract contexts to create a strong emotional impact on the listener. The prime function of Tempesta as a topic within a piece of abstract instrumental music is therefore to stimulate the listener into engaging with the music more closely, and thereby gaining the reward of an emotional frisson. In an age when audience members were easily distracted by the various social activities that might be in progress at the same time as the music, Tempesta was a useful way for composers to gain greater attention. So in the 18th century, people didn't sit in rows and quietly listen to the music. They would be playing cards, they would be talking, they would be getting drunk, all kinds of things. Some other things I won't mention. And if a composer wants to get their attention, then something like Tempesta is great because people sit up and listen and they pay attention when they hear something like that. So it's useful for that. Now, a lot of writing has been devoted to the extraordinary symphonic works that Haydn composed in the late 1760s, the early 1770s, and I'm not going to try to summarise them all here, but there is a lot of scholarship on this subject. When these works are looked at, it's not difficult to find the various Tempesta features. And if you look at figure 2 on your handout, you can see what we have. You may notice the symphonies along the top are in a funny order, 39, 26, 49, 44, 52, 45. We think that's the right chronological order now. The original numbering was incorrect, so that's why those numbers look a bit strange. But that gives you a rough idea. They were written between 1765 and 1772, roughly, we think. On the left-hand side, we have different musical characteristics of Tempesta. rapid scales, I'm going up and down very fast, chromaticism, using notes outside the scale, leaps or angular lines, so instead of a tune that goes da 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 da, the tune goes da da pop 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 pop, leaps about all over the place. Pauses. Pauses are absolutely fantastic for getting everyone's attention. You all stopped and listened then. If you were daydreaming, you suddenly woke up. So, pauses, they're very good for scaring audiences. The heart rate just goes a little faster. Trommelbass, this is the German for bum 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 bum, down in the bass, repeated notes, fast notes like a drum. Tremolando, of course, you know. Tirade. Tirade come up a lot. This is a brilliant, brilliant, brilliant. Sort of a coup d'archet in French. Also, they talk about this. There aren't any of these, actually, in the Haydn symphonies here, but they do come up elsewhere. Dotted rhythms. Bum, ba-bum, ba-bum, ba-bum. Which is like an irregular heartbeat. This is scary as well. And also syncopation, the same thing. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. It's your heart messing you around, making you more scared. Octaves, just bare octaves with no harmony. This can sound very scary as well. And finally, dynamic contrast. So suddenly loud, suddenly soft, suddenly loud, suddenly soft. It unsettles audiences. You're laughing. You're supposed to be scared. I'm not scary enough, obviously. So, all of the movements here are first movements and finales, and they're all fast, and they're all in minor keys. And four out of the six are flat minor keys. And my research has revealed that after about 1760, if you want to make an Ombra reference or a Tempesta reference, about one third of the examples are in C minor. One third in one key, C minor. Another third are in D minor. And the other third are in other keys, but very often flat minor keys, G minor, F minor, sometimes in sharp minor keys, sometimes in E flat major. All Jommelli's ghost scenes in his operas, he wrote about six or seven operas with ghost scenes in, every single one is in E flat major. And he put them in. Metastasio, the librettist, didn't like the supernatural, he took all the supernatural elements away. Jommelli liked to write a ghost scene, so he put one in, even if it wasn't in the plot, he put a ghost scene in because it was popular with the audience. And they're in E flat major, but then he uses the minor, of course, as well. All of these examples here exhibit tonal instability. They move very rapidly from one key to another, especially in development sections. Now, of course, you expect development sections anyway to pass through keys quite rapidly, but here, perhaps more so than normal, and again, flat minor keys feature very prominently. Now, given that many of the Tempesta features routinely appear in development sections of practically all Sonata 4 movements, the ticks that I've put here on the handout are confined to material observable in the exposition and the recapitulation only, okay? Because you expect it to move in the development, so that's what's going on there. So they're only included if a reasonably substantial example is in the exposition or in recapitulation. It should be said that in any given movement, the features indicated do not necessarily arise at the same time, but they don't often appear in isolation. Usually two or three of these will appear at the same moment together. And of course, if you hear a diminished seventh chord on its own, or you hear some syncopation on its own, that doesn't necessarily mean the music is scary. Okay? It's only if it's diminished seventh and trombones and tremolando and a flat minor key, then you start to think, okay, this is going to be scary. That's really the point. It's combinations. The commonest feature on this melodic line, on this diagram, is a melodic line which is disjunct, a line that jumps about all over the place. This is very typical of Haydn in this period. And noticeably, all the flat minor key symphonies have got this characteristic of a melody that jumps about. That's really important. The other very common feature is a tonneau bass, boom, 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 in the bass. This is very common. Tirade, not so much. Not at all, in fact, in these examples. But interestingly, they do appear in examples by Haydn in some of his theatre works and some of his religious works. So this is a context where they do appear, but not in his symphonies. He also doesn't use chromaticism very much, although he does use chromatic chords quite a lot. Diminished sevenths, augmented sixths, Neapolitan chords, these are very common in these works. The greatest concentration of tempesta elements is to be found in number 52, and this is in C minor. It was written in 1771, and it shows very well this disjunct melodic line. And that's the example I played earlier on. I'm sorry that I didn't have control of the machine. So this material comes back in F minor in the development, so flatter. And something I didn't say very briefly, just to explain, flat minor keys. If you look at examples of supernatural scenes in Henry Purcell, for instance, he uses C minor, he uses F minor. These keys were not only dark, they were more out of tune because they didn't use equal temperament then. So as you go further and further away from A minor, and you add more flats particularly, it becomes very out of tune. So the witch in Dido and Aeneas, she's in F minor, and that music would sound really rough in that tuning of that time. So although by the time we get to Haydn, the equal temperament was much more common, there was still this association of flat minor keys being scarier somehow because they were originally more out of tune. F minor also returns at the start of the recapitulation. That's the wrong key to be in at the start of the recapitulation, but there it is. And then the second phrase goes flatter still, so we're in B flat minor for a while. These works, all of these Sturm und Drang symphonies, dominate the early repertoire of symphonic stormy music, and with good reason. They clearly show evidence of a master composer experimenting with apparently new musical ideas, mainly in minor keys, which exhibit a restless, even turbulent character that many have recognised as foreshadowing Beethoven and the Romantics. The idea that this was related to some kind of personal crisis in Haydn's life is complete nonsense. He wasn't having a crisis, but some people have tried to say so. And this is because Beethoven had a crisis, and so they thought, well, maybe Haydn must have had a crisis. He didn't. Haydn had no crises. He was a very, very relaxed man. I think the only crisis was when in 1809 one of Napoleon's cannonballs came and landed near his house in Vienna. That's probably the only crisis he ever had in his life. So Haydn, of course, is not alone. There are other composers who are exploring this territory as well. So this proves that it's not a personal crisis at all. And of course, there are examples by Haydn which are not Sturm und Drang symphonies. If you look at his overtures to his operas, Philemon and Baucis, L'Isola Disabitata and La Vera Constanza, and also his oratorio Il Ritorno di Tobia, these have stormy writing that sounds just the same as the Sturm und Drang symphonies, but in a different context. So it's just a style that he's using. Haydn didn't invent it. There's a significant number of pieces or individual movements among 18th century concertos and symphonies that have a storm-related subtitle, usually involving the word tempesta, and a smaller number of works where some kind of extra-musical commentary helps to convey the intentions of the composer. Relating the music found here to similar passages in abstract works helps explain why a fashion for stormy rhetoric in non-programmatic instrumental music took hold. Composers began to explore the expressive possibilities of tempesta in an environment where no direct reference to storms was intended. As with ombra, they discovered that this more powerful kind of writing gained the attention of audiences all too easily distracted by the circumstances of performance that prevailed at the time and even served to operate on their emotions. The music demanded to be listened to. Both ombra and tempesta emerge as important contributors to a range of musical signifiers that we now call topics. Tempesta features much more regularly, not only in minor key symphonies, but in major key works, where exploring the minor becomes part of the discourse, part of the discussion, especially in development sections of sonataform movements. Haydn and others continue to use tempesta references long after the Sturm und Drang period was over, so it carries on after as well as before. So, what I want to do now is to return to the theatrical origins of tempesta. And note that I'm going to use the word tempesta now. Sturm und Drang is in the bin. A couple of examples. I could play you lots. I'm just going to play you a couple from the many I could mention. And they will show you how the style developed through the century. Storms proved very popular in France in the early years of the 18th century. In particular, there was a storm scene in Marin Marais, wrote an opera called Alcyon, and this storm scene was very influential, and all of the French composers after Marais put a storm in. Again, even if there wasn't one in there, they put one in to show that they could write a good storm. It's important for orchestration as well, because this is the first time the double bass was used as an expressive instrument, the first time that the piccolo was used, and the double bass for thunder, the piccolo for lightning in the storms. So it's extending the range of pitches that composers would use in the music in these French storm scenes. So there's Marais. Go away and listen to Marais. We don't have time. I'm going to play you some Rameau. And you'll find on your handout a list of examples that I'm going to play to you. So this Rameau is from Hippolyte et Arici. The date is 1733, okay? And let me just find the right track. It sounds like this. So, it's in a major key, so it's not as scary as a minor key, but in a major key, you can go up and down the scales very, very quickly, very, very easily on your string instruments. Lots of tremolando, lots of dynamic changes, loud and soft, very effective as a storm. As we move towards the middle of the century, the flat minor keys start to appear more and more. And we have Gluck already experimenting with Tempesta. So the best example is the end of his ballet Don Juan. And this is the same story as Don Giovanni. At the end, the statue comes back and there is some scary ombre music, which I'd like to play you, but we don't have time. It's a really good piece of ombre, though, with a statue making lots of scary sounds, trombones, D minor, of course, good ombre key. And then it goes straight into stormy music, and the storm is the demons, the devils coming out of the ground. They come up through trapdoors, and they're holding flames in their hands. And it's no surprise that I think this ballet received 6 performances at the Kärntner Tor Theatre in Vienna, and then it burnt down. I wonder why. The demons set fire to it, I think. So Don Giovanni, Don Juan, is dragged down to hell, and this is the music that Gluck wrote for them. Table, figure 3, you can follow. Like that. Somehow he manages to keep the tension there, keeps the audience frightened. And of course, this music, two things to note. The date, 1761. That's 15 years before Klinger wrote Sturm und Drang. Nothing to do with Sturm und Drang. 1761. The second thing to notice is that Boccherini, the Italian composer who came to live and work in Spain, stole this music and put it in a symphony, and it was the finale of the symphony. He transposed it to C minor to make it more scary, because it's a flatter key, and he subtitled the symphony La Casa del Diablo. So, and no copyright, he just stole it. It's the same, it's exactly the same. So, I have an even earlier example to play you. This is by a French composer called François Martin. Not very many people know him, but he wrote a symphony in G minor, Opus 4, number 2. It was published in 1751, but we think he wrote it even earlier than that. So it really predates Haydn and Gluck by quite some time. He was a composer who wrote big motets for the French Concert Spirituel in Paris. And so he knew all about the French and their taste for stormy music in opera. So he was drawing on that in this symphony. So it's a really good example to keep in mind. Thank you. lot of our Stormy characteristics are there in the music. 1751, 25 years before Sturm und Drang. So we really don't need it. Now, of course, I haven't played you any Mozart yet. We ought to hear an example by Mozart. Everyone knows the G minor symphony, the earlier one, number 25. This is a very famous example, often quoted as Mozart writing in Sturm und Drang. So I shan't play you that one. I shall play you something different. This you probably won't know. It's the incidental music that he wrote to an Egyptian play called Temos König in Ägypten. At the end of this, we have probably Mozart's most powerful Tempesta writing. After a very stormy passage depicting the punishment of the villain, Fearon, he's punished by the gods, and he's whipped, and then he's struck by lightning. Which is fantastic, great piece of drama. And at one point, there's about a 30-bar passage of just a single line of music, but it's very scary, even though there's nothing, there's no harmony, it's just strings on their own, but very effective. And then you hear angular lines, brass and timpani, offbeat accents, you'll hear, well, lots of other stuff. Look, you don't need me to describe it for you, you can hear it in the music. He's pretty dead, I think, at the end of that. If I played you that without telling you, I don't think many of you would have said Mozart. That doesn't sound like the Mozart we normally know. It's very different. Okay, the last thing I want to do before I take some questions is just to ask a rhetorical question, really, which is, well, if we're not going to call this kind of music Sturm und Drang, then what aesthetic does it belong to? What is the background to this kind of feeling? Why are people interested in writing about the supernatural in literature or in painting or in poetry as well as in music? And of course, the context here is Gothic literature, the rise of the Gothic novel, the kinds of paintings that we see at this time by Fuseli and Luthenberg and people like this. People were fascinated by the gloomy, by the scared, scary, by the terrifying. And we can trace the origin quite a long way back, but the main person responsible for disseminating this idea was an English-Irish politician and philosopher called Edmund Burke. And so what I've done on the handout, if you look on the figure four, is to give you some quotations related to something called the sublime of terror. In the 18th century, people were philosophically interested in the idea of the sublime, the highest emotional feeling that you could have in response to art or nature or whatever it might be. And one of the things that was identified was that terror, to be terrified, was the highest emotional state out of all of these. So the terror is associated with the sublime. And we have a very early example from 1704. This is 2 years before Marais wrote Alcyon. So a very early example. John Dennis, an English playwright and commentator. And he gave the sources of the sublime gods, demons, hell, spirits and souls of men, miracles, prodigies, enchantments, witchcrafts, thunder, tempests, raging seas, inundations, torrents, earthquakes, volcanoes, monsters, serpents, lions, tigers, fire, war, pestilence, famine, etc. Phew. That's quite a lot of scary things in one go there. All right, lions and tigers, they're not supernatural, but most people would not have seen lions and tigers, so they're in their imagination, so they're more scary, perhaps, than the real thing. But yeah, all these other things are things that you find in opera scenes all the time in the early 18th century. So, Edmund Burke picked up this idea in 1758, a very important piece that he wrote, a book that he wrote. Whatever is fitted in any sort to excite the ideas of pain and danger, that is to say, whatever is in any sort terrible, and by terrible he means inspiring terror, okay? Or is conversant about terrible objects, or operates in a manner analogous to terror, all of those, that's a source of the sublime. That is, it is productive of the strongest emotion which the mind is capable of feeling. Indeed, terror is in all cases whatsoever, either more openly or latently, the ruling principle of the sublime. So Burke is all about the sublime of terror. His book was translated into all the European languages. It spread all over Europe. It was a bestseller. Haydn had a copy in his library. We think Mozart read it as well. It was a very, very influential book. And then the other two examples, I shan't read them to you now, you can look at them, but these are, Burke wasn't a musician, so he didn't try to define it in musical terms. Daniel Webb, he understood music, and so he talks about how music can be terrifying. And then Michaelis, who was a great polymath in Germany in 1805, looking back at the classical period, gives all these examples of frightening music and how it can be frightening. So lots of different things there. So I'll finish by saying that Michaelis, he brings us very close, if you read his description, to some of the greatest pieces of stormy music ever written. And these are in the Fifth Symphony of Beethoven and the Sixth Symphony of Beethoven. You have to listen to those works in the context of Ombra and Tempesta. And E.T.A. Hoffmann, himself a composer as well as a writer, he observed, Beethoven's music sets in motion the machinery of awe, fear, of terror, of pain, and awakens that infinite yearning which is the essence of romanticism. So Hoffmann recognized Ombra and Tempesta, that's the way forward for the romantics, that's the way we have to go. There can be no clearer acknowledgement of the powerful effect that Beethoven's music was capable of exerting on audiences, and Tempesta was undoubtedly the strongest form of expression he used. When considering the influence that Beethoven then had on subsequent generations, Tempesta must be recognised as one of the most important aspects of his legacy. And that's where I'll finish my talk today. Thank you very much for listening.
Very much for this fascinating lecture, or should I say performance. It was really lively and
that's what I tried to do.
Really rich. Thanks very much.
Good.
Are there any questions?
They're too frightened.
Probably.
Yeah, I've scared them.
I'm struggling with the sublime terror. Because I think the sublime is just in relation to the big tension to the happiness. The sublime is not the terror for itself, it's the big tension which creates the terror, wanting the happiness. The big difference.
But you're missing the important point, which is that people want to be terrified. It's the same reason why you go on a roller coaster or watch a horror movie. It is a happiness because we want extra stimulation.
As well, this extra stimulation to recognize the other side, isn't it?
Yeah, sure. But it's still, I mean, the important thing is that Burke, writing in the middle of the century, says the most sublime, the German writers use the word Erhabene, that the most sublime sensation that you can have is when you are terrified. He doesn't say it's necessarily a bad thing. Being terrified can be a good thing. It cleanses you, makes you feel happier to be alive. You know, if you go on a bungee jump down into a ravine and then back up again, yeah, you feel glad to be alive at the end of that because you really face death.
But isn't this feeling after that stronger?
Yes,
to be glad that you.
It's the most sublime. Terrifying is the most sublime. That's more sublime than just being happy because it's a nice day. Any other questions? Yes.
Hi.
I'm
actually curious because we do some this material recognized. We do a Beethoven, an Opus 95, the Opus Euros, which has every single thing on this checklist.
Yes.
And I never look at it this way.
Okay.
Find a way how this makes total sense in a special way.
Yes.
It's already getting into difficult territory, but it generates the content, the tension from our. So I'm wondering, in a big talk, or I guess in a big talk, how much would you say that the tempest is a motor of the music, or the music, the decisions taken in the music are circle habits? So it seems that when you talked about it, timing, it's a way to grab attention.
Yes.
But it's also the choice of keys and the choice of things that are in there.
Yes.
Could be to generate this scariness.
Yes.
It could come from trying to scare people. So
yes.
How much do you think this changed, or?
It's very difficult to say. I think you have to view it as a tool in the composer's toolbox, along with all the other topics that we talk about in topic theory. They're consciously using them. And I think for Haydn, he sort of discovered it. Maybe he heard some Gluck or some Martin when he was in Paris or something. And he wanted to think, yeah, okay, I can experiment with that. I don't necessarily think... when Beethoven does this, I think he's doing it to push the boundaries still further. It's to make. There are different ways of making audiences feel uncomfortable. Haydn does it through humour as well. He uses humorous devices to unsettle the audience and get their attention. So he'll use pauses, or he'll, you know, the famous string quartet and all this kind of thing. So it's another kind of playfulness, if you like. Yes, it's scary, but it's scary happy. It's playing with the audience and saying, here's some scary music, but there are no witches, there are no demons, there is no thunderbolt. It's just music that sounds scary. Let's have some fun with that. So it's a tool for the composer to use. Now, Beethoven, of course, is another step forward. Of course, he's writing in a much later style. He's pushing the boundaries further in all kinds of ways. And these kind of characteristics, he's using them maybe not as a storm reference, but just using these tools to make the music more disjunct, to make it more experimental, if you like. You listen to late Beethoven quartets, I mean, they're scary for a different reason. They're not scary because they have lots of ombra or tempesta. They're scary because they don't really make sense until you really, really engage with them over about 50 years. Spohr, who was the leading composer of the day, said, late Beethoven? It's rubbish, the man's mad, you know, I don't get it. He was a great composer, and he didn't get late Beethoven. I don't get late Beethoven, I don't really. I'm sorry, I don't like the Missa Solemnis, and I don't like the Ninth Symphony. I don't really like the late quartets, apart from the C-sharp minor, which is great. And of course, Schubert recognised the C-sharp minor was a great symphony. It's the last thing he heard before he died. He had got people to come around to play it to him on his deathbed. So C-sharp minor quartet of Beethoven is a special one. But a lot of late Beethoven actually doesn't really make a great deal of sense to me. I'm still struggling to cope with it. So he's just, the horizons are so wide that it's impossible to understand, I think. So for what it's worth, that's what I think's going on. Yes?
Maybe it's not a question, but I'm interested about your opinion about that. My feeling is, despite all the modern tools we have today to scare people.
Yes, yes.
With the soundtracks.
Yes.
Even with the normal advertisements.
Yeah, yes.
Everywhere.
Yes.
When you go to the proper situation with Gluck,
yeah,
or Fiona Ricci, and you go to the Inferno,
yes,
you still feel something.
Yes, you do.
Extraordinarily,
sure,
powerful.
Yes.
What's the reason for that?
Well, I think the reason, to turn the question the other way around, if you look at cinema music, it's basically drawing on the principles of ombra and tempesta. You think of Jaws, da-dum, 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 low-pitched sound, repetitive, ominous, semitone, no sense of key, it's very scary. You think of Psycho, very high, very dissonant, stabbing motion, you know, yeah, all right, you're laughing, but it's scary. You also have to understand that our boundaries for scariness have changed a little bit. You think of a classic example that I teach is the Wolf's Glen scene in Weber's Der Freischütz. Now this, when you listen to the music, it's very, very scary. And Weber was actually involved in the design. The Neue Schauspielhaus in Berlin had been burnt down just before. He was able to design a new theatre which could do far more modern things than previously. They used all kinds of special effects that were not available, including using magic lanterns to project images, which at the time, you know, to us this wouldn't be scary to see an image, a still image of a woman on a rock. That's not scary. But to an audience in 1819, this is witchcraft. You know, it's to have a light projecting things onto a wall. So the technology changes as we go on. And yeah, now in films, you can do anything with CGI, with all kinds of synthesized sounds. You can make it as scary as you want. Almost anything. The sky is the limit. So in some ways, it's not as scary because you know anything can happen. The beauty of the music, the beauty of Gluck, is that it's within certain boundaries, and then he transcends them. And it's the transcending of the boundaries that makes it uncomfortable. If you're interested, I have written a paper about the film score for the 1935 black and white horror movie Bride of Frankenstein. This is a score by Franz Waxman, and he was a German Jewish emigre who went to work in Hollywood. So he was steeped in the romantic tradition, in Weber and Wagner, in Liszt, and he took that style into Hollywood, and all those cliches that we associate with horror movie music are because they were brought to America through the German emigre composers. So that's where all that comes from. So yes, you can trace it through, and the musical language changes a little bit, but actually you can trace them all back to the examples we've been talking about today, and even earlier. You can go back to Monteverdi, Orfeo, trombones in the hell scene. You know, so gradually more and more elements are added as you go along. Okay? I think maybe we've... Oh, one more question. Go on.
I've got a question about one thing you mentioned. You talked about English Gothic literature.
Yes.
And I understand that this literature is... there's a cultural market to it, so it was developed in England.
Yes.
Quite a lot before in other countries.
Yes.
It's kind of a... Catholic critical point to it, if we think about Joseph Ferdinand of Sheridan of Fanu,
yes,
for example, the Castle of Otranto, all
yes,
this stuff. And I wondered if in literature we have this special cultural marker, if in music there might be also something detectable about this.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think there are cultural markers in literature, in poetry, even Gray's Elegy on a Country Churchyard. You know, I mean, that's actually tapping into to that thing as well. But it's in painting too, as well. So it isn't just literature. It is the zeitgeist. If you know, people have used this Sturm und Drang label because they said, oh well, this stuff is going on at the same time, so it's the zeitgeist. This is what people are thinking. But it doesn't work because the time is wrong. The association is wrong because it's not supernatural. And I'm absolutely clear that all these musical characteristics come from supernatural associations. And also because Sturm und Drang was taking place in Berlin, Haydn was working in Vienna. I mean, yeah, all right, they speak the same language, but culturally they're a long way apart. They're very, very, you know, Northern Protestant Berlin and Southern Catholic Vienna are very different places at this time. So I don't understand this link that people have made. I think the idea of the sublime of terror is much more pervasive, is much more common, and we know that Burke's book was disseminated right throughout Europe. It sold hundreds of thousands of copies. It was very, very influential. And there you're looking at a philosopher who is understanding the spirit of the age and writing about it in philosophical terms, and relating it to poetry, to literature, to novels, to plays, and to art, to paintings, all of these things, as well as, of course, to music, which those subsequent quotations on the handout show you how people then start to associate it with music as well. Okay? Sorry, it's a long answer, but this is it. I get going on my favourite topic. It's, I think it's very dangerous talking about borders. I think it's more fluid than that. It takes place gradually. I could play you some examples of Handel
yeah.
that are more scary than Gluck, actually. So if you take He Sent a Thick Darkness in his Israel and Egypt, this is one of the plagues, the seven plagues that were sent down to punish the Egyptians. And the music that he writes there is so discontinuous for something written in 1738. Really, really very modern, very strange indeed, and that's Handel. And there are lots of examples in Handel, rage arias, all those fantastic arias that Joyce Di Donato sings, expressing rage and tempest, flat minor keys, and all the rest of it. They're all in there.
So maybe it could be a transition from the, it's very direct in the Handel operas, the feelings or the storms.
Yeah.
And then the tempest of this period, Haydn, maybe it is a transition from the direct expression storm,
yeah,
to the what you said before, the Sturm und Drang, the more emotional of the romanticism. So
yeah,
this tempest of Haydn,
okay,
is the transition from the direct to the...
Yeah, I'm uncomfortable with putting things in boxes because I think it's more fluid.
Yeah.
There's Handel and there's Gluck, but in between you have Hasse, you have Jommelli, you have Traetta, you have all these lesser-known composers now, but they were very well-known at the time, who were all just gradually taking this music and moving forward with it. It's just a gradual process. It's not that Handel is different from Gluck, it's that Handel is at one point on the spectrum along with all these other people. Okay. I think maybe we have to stop because
yes,
there's a concert coming up.
May I suggest that we continue somewhere else? There's a cup of wine awaiting us.
We can't miss the wine, so.
But we can continue. We continue the discussion, of
course.
Okay,
sure.
So thanks a lot, Miss Moore.